Development Lab, currently working on his next invention.
It's alive.
I have many inventions. Many of them.
That's you why know, you're in the lab.
You know milk, when you drink milk in the bottle, just after 1 week, 10 days, it gets rotten. So I have it for 1 year in cooler.
So you can keep milk for a year?
A year and nothing.
It won't curdle?
No.
Wow.
A year?
Special device that I invented.
Interesting.
That's great.
Wow.
Okay. Gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm Tiffany Rothman from Fielder 90211 with my wonderful and amazing co-host, Chris Sloan. Here with us today, we had the pleasure of having Hooshang Brown with his pre-decay baby tea cleaning products. And Chase Lewis, the impressionist singer and comedian.
Yes, thank you.
And Wendy Wilkins, the author of Sex, Love, and Cops, and the Formal Cops from Melbourne, Australia.
All the way from Australia.
Well, I've been here for 18 years. So.
Well, I had to make it dramatic.
Came all this way for this, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good
afternoon. And for this.
Yeah. Good afternoon. How's everyone doing today? How's your week, Chris?
My week was phenomenal. The weather cooled down because it got really hot for a while, and I enjoyed the cooler temperatures, and it's easier to go out and do a long bike ride. So yesterday I did about a 42-mile ride.
Wow.
You and your bike ride. He loved riding bike.
I love it when the weather's a little bit cooler.
Wow.
Yeah. That's wonderful. It was a good week. Mm. And how about you, Tiffany? How was your week?
I worked hard. I have three auditions. Yeah.
I know. She keeps bragging about that today.
No,
to
I can't help it.
You know, Chris, I had three auditions. What did you have?
I only had two, so you win. What about you?
Every week, I got an audition for this, and I got an audition for that, and I'm in this movie and that movie. What are you doing, Chris? I'm here, Tiffany. This is where I'm at.
Actually, my audition, one of them was for voiceover, and another one is for the theater playing and auditioning for an older lesbian.
Oh,
which is great, you know.
That sounds fun.
Yes, who changed her tune, who changed her life, her midlife, you know, she recognized who she is, and now she have to tell her husband and her kid, and it was...
That sounds cool.
But it was a
So are you
going to
dig into
story.
That character, go method on that, and live it?
If I got higher... I might. I'll let you know.
Okay.
I was thinking that. Yeah.
I need to be the first to know.
Yes,
that.
You'll be the first to know.
And it would be funny if she becomes a lesbian after doing method acting, right?
Yeah, husband might sue.
Right.
But then this morning I auditioned for two roles. They both are criminals. One's really hardcore, and another one, the senile. That I really like.
I want to see you do the hardcore criminal with guns.
The senile one is fun. She's with a gun, too.
I know. I want to see you with a gun.
Okay.
That would be interesting.
You'll be the first to know.
I want to know.
Get a fake gun and start waving it around.
Well, yeah, that's not probably not how you use a gun.
We got a full house today.
That's what everybody did.
Right.
Yes, we have full house today. I'm so happy to see you guys here.
It's kind of cozy.
Yes.
I like it.
Yes, yeah.
We got some warm light. I feel like I have a nice amber light on my face. Compared to the fry bin light that I had a couple weeks ago, I felt like I was Chicken McNugget sitting, waiting for somebody to buy me. But it was good lighting. This is different. Every week we kind of play around with the lighting and see what kind of mood we want to create. Create a sensual mood or an upbeat mood or, you know, kind of a serious, just serious mood. So I don't know what kind of mood we've got this week.
What kind of mood are you in, Chris?
I'm in a good mood. A little bit wacky today?
Yes, I know. I know. Would you like to talk about it?
Well, no. But we have Alex here who does impersonations, so then I started crawling into it, doing my impersonations, which puts me in a little bit of a wacky mood.
Well, we're in our bunker here right now at infowars.com. It's we're at the home of where sex trafficking and Hollywood happens everywhere and up in the Hollywood Hills, and We got to stop it right now at InfoWars.com. Get all the information you need. We got all the supplements, all the pills you need right there at InfoWars.com to stop these Satanists trying to kill our children here in Hollywood. InfoWars.com.
Sponsored by InfoWars.com.
Hey, I didn't know I was on that podcast.
And Wendy, I'm excited to have you here today.
Thank you.
Not that I've had you. I'm so excited to have you here today. Because
thanks for clarifying.
See, I told you I'm in one of those moods. Yeah. Because there's a lot of conversation that we had on the pre-show about your background, and it's really intriguing. Really intriguing. So I can't wait to just dig into it.
What do you want to know?
Everything. I want to know it all.
Okay. Which one do you want to know first? Is it sex, love, or cops?
I like the idea of twisting them all together and making it one. Sex, love, and cops.
That's what I did in my memoir.
That's great. Yeah. So how old were you when you became a cop?
Yeah, I was 19. I did it for 5 years. So
teenager.
A cop at 19. Picture a 19-year-old Australian cop.
With legs like
a teenager's dream.
For sure.
Well, I did get asked out by the criminals, which was pretty weird.
Really?
They actually wanted you to handcuff them, huh?
Yeah, kind of. It was, yeah. There was,
but you did. She did anyway. She probably handcuffed them first, then released them and got asked.
Actually, I didn't even think about that, getting handcuffed.
The first person I handcuffed was a 16-year-old girl who was going crazy. I can't even remember what we were arresting her for, but she was kicking everybody and yelling out at the same time we were arresting her. I want IID, which is Internal Investigations Department.
Wow, really?
So she'd obviously been through the ringer before. And yeah, so that was an interesting experience.
And what city was this in?
This was in Melbourne, Australia.
Okay.
Sound like it could be in LA or New York.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or New Orleans.
It's like an everyday occurrence here.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we didn't want to handcuff her, but she was kicking and screaming and, you know, we really had no choice. And then when we put her in the back of the police car, she was trying to kick out the windows and, yeah.
Wow.
And she was only 16. It was really
crazy. She on something?
I don't even know. I just remember that was my first handcuff experience.
So that was your first caller?
Yeah.
What about the guys? I mean, that they, I'm sure these gentlemen want to know how you cuff the guys.
Yes. It's all about the cuff.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, it was interesting, actually, because I was a really nice cop, I thought. So I would ask them to put their hands behind their back or get into the police car and we're going to go.
I would have just put them behind my back as soon as I saw you.
Well, they did mostly. And, you know, because I was being nice and said, we're going to go down the station for a chat. So
a chat or a check?
Chat.
Oh, okay.
A talk. And most of the time they got in. And so,
because I would have said, I'm ready for my cavity search. Go ahead.
Well, I was telling you before that in Australia, females search females and males search males. But
it's so boring.
Well, I did have an interesting experience, but about the sergeants at my station tried to play tricks on me because I was so naive. I was 19 and they'd called me Gullible's Travels, so everything that, you know, they were making jokes all the time. But we had this, I worked in an area kind of like Hollywood, you know, so we had a lot of tourism but a lot of street prostitutes. So there was this one transvestite, I think it's called, I mean, I'm really bad with labels, but she was halfway through, you know, taking hormones, so had the boobs but not the the chop yet. And her name was Robin Wright, actually, which was pretty interesting. But anyway, I got asked to strip search her, and halfway through I realized she had quite a big Adam's apple and
quite the shoulders.
Yeah, yeah. And and you know, she was really nice though and being very flirtatious with me, but then I could see through the window that the sergeant was kind of, you know, trying to see through, you know, for me to be like, oh my God.
He was peeping is what you're saying.
He was peeping. Yeah. And halfway,
he was being a voyeur.
He was, and thought that I would get caught and shocked. And but anyway, halfway through, I said, "Robin, have you had the operation yet?" And she said, "No." So mm-hmm. I said, "I'm going to get a male officer." So that's what happened. Yeah.
Your first caller. Oh, no, that wasn't your first caller, was it?
Well, no. Well, actually, she was charged with armed robbery because she was a street prostitute and she was getting her johns to go down an alleyway, and then two young guys would come with tomahawks and rob them for their watches and money. But wow. Most wouldn't report it because
the embarrassment of it.
Yeah.
So if you're a John out there watching, don't go down dark alleys.
Yeah. Yeah.
Keep it safe. Be somewhere where there's still some people around. Protect yourself. I mean, because, you know, I think prostitution's probably the oldest profession in the world, one of them. Mm-hmm. And there's always going to be Johns out there. So protect yourself, you know? Don't be stupid.
Take the advice from Chris.
Be smart. Not that I was ever a John. I heard about it. Yeah.
Sure.
Wendy told me.
Well, yeah.
So how does a 19-year-old girl in Australia decide? And you know, so the way you look, I mean, you could have immediately went into modeling.
Thank you.
Aww. Acting, of course you did. You've done it all since. But at that point, you said, no, I want to be a cop. So what was the motivation behind that? Because that's a serious decision, because it's a dangerous profession.
Yeah, I didn't think too much about the danger at the time, but, you know, I wanted to be a lawyer. I wanted to help people, and then I didn't want to go to school for that long, so I thought, okay, I'll become a cop. And but backtracking a little bit, when I was a child, I used to play act, you know, make shows up, and so I always wanted to be an actress, I think, but never had the path that was a career. You know, my family didn't think that was a career option. So
it's hard.
Yeah. So I ended up becoming a cop, and you know, I was really wanted to help people, and I was also interested. Every time I saw a police car, I wanted to know what was going on and, you know, what was happening. So there was a bit of that as well. And then once I joined, you know, after 5 years, I was still, I don't know if the right word is enjoyed the job, but, you know, I found it interesting. And you know, I did undercover as a prostitute as well, and a few things.
So maybe I didn't know that
led me.
You okay, have any pictures?
So hold on.
Any picture you can show to Chris?
So how did you prepare yourself to be an undercover prostitute?
Well, the funny thing is, my sergeant said, "Hey, it's not like Pretty Woman. Just you know,
look rough."
Yes, no, that's exactly.
Have your hair all over your head.
That's exactly.
So like you know, a little Jay? Tear in your stockings.
Wait, how do you know?
Oh, you gotta make a living somehow.
He watches a lot of TV.
So
TV?
So it was kind of like he just said, "Don't wash your hair for a few days."
Oh wow! Because, I don't like those types of prostitutes.
Well, unfortunately, most of the prostitutes on the street at that time—this was in the 80s—were heroin addicts, you know, and so it was, and so they were.
So their hygiene wasn't up to snuff.
It was a real
teeth weren't great.
difficult you know, revolving circle, because they, you know, do what they were doing to get the hits, and then they needed the hit to do what they were doing. So, you know, it was very sad, you know. But anyway, so every now and then we would do what was called a cleanup operation on the streets. And
wait, cleanup operations.
So does that mean like you get rid of all the prophylactics and stuff?
Well, it wasn't it wasn't really the prostitutes, it was really the Johns, you know, because...
Oh, the people, you mean, clean up the people.
So it was to sort of stop, because it was illegal, street prostitution was illegal, so, but it was fairly condoned, I suppose, but every 6 months we'd do that, so that's what my undercover job once was,
How many time did you go undercover?
A few, but it was interesting. I could have made a lot of money. It was like...
As a prostitute,
busy.
You mean?
It was busy. I was busier than I...
What
I
was the going rate back then?
Yeah, what was the going rate?
No, I can't remember, but the whole thing...
George?
The whole thing was...
You're good.
We had to
good?
Say... Yeah. Okay. It's fine. We had to say, you know, what do you want? You know, how much? And then pull out our badge, which was called a Freddy, and then I don't know why, don't ask me why, and then that's what we called it, and then our sergeant or you know, would come from the shadows and arrest the John.
Yeah
So and they just get a fine. But one time there was someone that had just, it was quite potentially dangerous because someone had just done an armed robbery and had a shotgun in the back and almost ran over a policewoman. So
wow.
So yeah, so it was,
I was going to ask you, what was the most dangerous moment in your law enforcement career?
Gosh, people always ask me that and I always forget, you know. But there was a lot of potentially dangerous situations. I think the scariest one for me was when I thought I was going to be shot. And it was about a month after I'd just actually traveled in America and come back. And while I was in America, there was a shooting of two young policemen. They were ambushed and shot and killed, and I knew them. And so we were down on a dark alley one night, and there was a car with the motor running, and you know, we pulled up, and over the loudspeaker said, you know, get out of the car, because we're checking on the person. And they wouldn't get out for a long time, so finally we had our firearms drawn. And remember, you know, this is the thing that people don't realize, it's all what's happened just before. You know, we're a few weeks before, we knew two young cops had been ambushed and killed, so the adrenaline's mm-hmm. very high. And then we kept saying to this man, you know, put your arms where we can see them. And I remember he went like this in his pocket, jacket pocket, and I thought he was going to shoot me. And it was a split second between me pulling a trigger and not. And he didn't even have a firearm. So that was the scariest for me, that I could have shot somebody.
So the fear was more that you were going to kill somebody, not somebody was going to kill you.
Yeah, I suppose. A bit of both, you know.
Yeah, of course.
A bit of both.
What was he reaching for?
You know, I don't know. And that's the stupid thing. And this is what makes me so angry when I hear about the shootings. I mean, I'm not defending these crazy cops, but, you know, I would say 95% of cops don't want to shoot anyone, you know.
Oh, yes. No, the thing is, like, most good cops do not want to shoot anyone.
Because you have to live with that, you know.
Yeah.
I knew a couple cops, and they said when they were police officer for 20 years, they never pulled out a gun.
No, so that's, like, really scary in itself. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I don't know why this man... I remember he didn't speak English, but it's pretty universal if someone pulls you up to put your hands up, you know?
Of course.
And I just don't understand. And you can't judge unless you're there, but if you get pulled up by the cops, put your hands up, you know?
Yeah.
Just,
common sense, yeah.
Yeah, that's my advice.
So here's the real question now. Let's just say you're a cop again. You're a cop.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a bad guy. And you've got me, and you need to crack me. You need to figure out what's going on, what am I doing. How would you go about doing that? So I'm like, you know, a wise guy, you know, cocky. You know, what would you do?
So, well...
And I'm talking about me, like Chris.
Yeah.
I know you don't know me well.
Yeah.
But, like, from the moments or minutes that you've already known me, what do you know about me? Because I know you got to profile personalities. You got to profile people. You got to survey the situation. So what would you do with me?
Well, I mean, that's hard to answer because it's like, do I know, you know, that you have a gun or do I know?
I don't have a gun.
Okay.
But I'm dangerous though.
But how do I know you? Do I know that about you?
Yes. You already know I don't have a gun, but you know, I'm like dangerous person.
Well, I'd keep my distance for a start.
That's right.
And I would, and is the situation I'm supposed to be arresting you for something?
I'm already arrested. Now you got to break me down.
You're in the station?
You're interrogating me now.
Oh, well, okay.
Yeah. That's... What would you do? Like, now, again, with me.
Yeah.
Based on what you know about me, what would you do? What tactics? How would you crawl into my head?
Well, I mean, it's been a while since I've been a cop, but I would probably, you know, it's interesting being an actress. It's like breaking down a script, right? You would just keep finding out more and more information, keep asking you questions, keep seeing your reactions. And, you know, there's certain things, you know, if you're telling a lie, you can kind of start to feel it, that, you know, you're not telling the truth. And, basically start to appeal to, you know, what you want to do. Do you want to get out of here? Do you want to go to jail again? Have you been in jail before? You know, all those sorts of things. So start to appeal to your personal comfort levels, and would be what I would.
And there's actually some people that want to go back to prison. Like, I was on the train one time with this guy with like a 5150 tattoo on his forehead. He was like, yeah, man, I can't get a job. Nobody wants to hire me. And he was like cussing, and he was cussing in front of like little kids. And he literally said, yeah, I just want to do something to get back into jail. Some people are like that.
You know,
yeah.
I had...
You can deal with the outside world, yeah.
The majority of them are like that. When I did my research, that's what they say to a psychiatrist, said that there's this criminal, he was very brilliant. He has a severe learning disability, but no one knew about it.
Right.
He can't read, but when he talks, he's so brilliant, he's very poetic, and he would do things to keep himself in prison.
Yeah.
And then they found, they realized that he's faking it. So they let him go. So what happened was when he...
Like Shawshank, prison, you know, the older character, he just couldn't handle the outside world, you know?
Yeah.
So when he got out, guess what he did? He provoked someone so they can kill him, and he ended up dead.
Wow.
So the true story.
Well,
in
that's
a few
the
months,
thing.
He couldn't get a job.
Yeah.
Couldn't function.
That's the frustrating thing, and I think one of the reasons I left the police force is because... First of all, I was too young to sort of stand up and be counted. I saw some things I didn't agree with. Secondly, I felt like I was mostly putting band-aids on, you know, arresting the same people.
Mm.
You know, I would make a joke. It's not that funny, but the dumb ones get caught. You know, that's all the time. That. So
you're saying I'm dumb? That's why I got caught?
Well, you said you got caught. So
well, does that mean
you're
I'm
in
dumb?
The station. Well, to go to... Well, I mean...
I don't like the way this is going. I think we should change that subject.
Maybe. I don't think you're really a criminal, so it's a hypothetical.
But do you think you'd be able to crawl in my head and crack me with the intelligence that I have and the savviness?
I don't know. I mean, it depends. Like, a lot of criminals get away with it. And that's the frustrating thing. So, you know, I left the police force because... I was at the stage to become a detective, where you basically have to spend your whole life, you know, more study, more, you know, being 24/7 a detective, basically. And I decided, time to move on, you know.
What was your personal life like when you were a cop?
Because you have to read my memoir, Sex, Love, and
Sex,
Cops on,
so,
on Amazon.
So,
Wendy, you read it, Chris.
Is an author of a book. And here is the cover.
Yeah.
Sex, Love, and Cops. I mean, it's a phenomenal combination. Look at those legs. I asked Wendy about those legs. They are her legs, which is exciting. It's a memoir, though. Now, what is the difference between a memoir and a novel?
Well, it's all true.
It's all true.
Yeah. Ooh. So it's exactly what happened. And, yeah, I did. So it was... Basically, I never meant to write this memoir, but I wanted to... I was writing screenplays, and I had so many chapters that a friend who had published a book said, you should make it into a book. And it's really for the real estate. I want to make it into a TV series like Sex and the City, but with cops.
Mm-hmm.
But I was so naive. I was 19, and I literally popped my cherry, so to speak, love-wise, sex-wise... My first punch in the face by another prostitute, and you know, my first murder, my first all of those things. So,
what do you mean your first murder?
Well, my first, not me, but someone that, you know, arresting people, you know, going to murders and things like that.
So it was a murder case?
Oh, there was many. Yeah, like basically, this is the interesting thing that, you know, if you think you're in the army or a cop, the younger you are, you're first on the scene for everything, and then they call in the detectives. So we go to the murders, the suicides, the every single thing that you call the cops for. The youngest ones are the ones that turn up first, which is kind of a bit crazy, really, if you think about it.
Here's a section that I just.
Oh.
Happened to skim through.
Right.
It's one of the page 68. So it says, working for the chief commissioner, or I'm not a bloody secretary. So was there a lot of sexism going on?
Well, that was a particular kind of sexism thing, I think, because, you know, I was a trainee still. What happens is you do your your academy, and then you do 2 years of training where you go out on the streets, but you're at different places. And for a month, I was sent to the chief commissioner's office, where basically my job was cutting out all the police articles in the newspaper, answering the phone, you know, police complaints, which I'll give you an example. Someone rang up and said, you know, how come the police can get to park everywhere they want for free? And, you know, I couldn't help myself. I said, so if your daughter's being raped, you want me to find a legal parking spot before we come to help her? So, you know, stop. She hung up. But things like that. So, I kept on calling my sergeant saying, listen, can you get me out of here? I want to be on the streets, you know, not answering the phone. So eventually they... Yeah, moved me out. But one thing that, a serious thing that happened while I was a cop, my roommate in the academy, she accidentally shot and killed her partner in a raid. And I made the biggest foot in my mouth mistake of my life, I suppose, because I thought she was on day shift and it was all over the news. And I called her up and I said, hey, Pam, you don't know who that policewoman was that shot her partner. And she said it was me.
Wow.
And so I started crying. She was crying. And, you know, it was really tragic. Oh, but God. She was in
her police partner. Right?
Yeah. Oh, and he'd only been married for 3 weeks. He was very young, or 6 weeks. Oh, and God. It was a total accident. And technically, it was her partner's fault, because they were raiding a house at like 3 a.m. This guy came out with a shotgun, pointed it at her, and her partner came from behind the shadows to disarm the guy with the shotgun, and it, you know, went off, and she shot her partner instead of the criminal. And the chief commissioner called me into his office, and he didn't know she was my partner, and said, now, what do you think about trainees carrying guns after this happened? You know, and I said, well, it could happen to anyone. It wasn't that she was a trainee. She had a shotgun pointed at her.
Mm-hmm.
And so what would you do? Like, if, you know, it was her being killed or him, you know. And then, but then the most tragic thing was the shotgun wasn't loaded. But he pointed it at her.
He's stupid, that criminal.
Yeah, I know.
Well, again, stupid criminals get caught, right?
So what happened? Did he go to jail for life?
No, she was exonerated, but she had to live with that for the rest of her life, you know?
Yeah, and so how do you deal with the stress, the anxiety, and it seems like at times in law enforcement, it's probably easy to slip into depression. Because of the lifestyle, and how did you handle that emotionally?
Did you go to a therapist a lot after you served?
No, I think I was too young. You know, I was so young that it didn't hit me really what I was doing. You know, I look back sometimes and I think, how did I? You know, I wouldn't want to be a cop today. Seriously, I feel so.
Political climate.
Yeah, it's a very hard job. No one, you know, like, so, but yeah, I think I just kept moving, I suppose. And I think if I knew that it was time to get out though, like if I look back.
So you had awareness,
yeah,
an inner awareness of what you needed to do.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about meeting one of Australia's most notorious criminals?
Wow, we're putting all this... People have to read the book. But, yeah.
It's a sneak peek.
Yeah. I've forgotten his name for a sec. He's very famous.
Constable? No.
No, on the back it's...
Eric?
Eric. You Banner? Know, well, Eric Banner played him. Chopper Reed.
Yeah,
yes.
That was a great movie.
Okay, so Chopper Reed came in to report on bail. So in those days, when you got out on parole, you would, I don't know if it's the same now or even in this country, but you'd go into the police station and sign the book, you know, and he came in and I didn't know who he was, and he had a big handlebar mustache, and he, you know, signed the book, and then he said, hey, you're pretty cute. What are you doing later today? How about we go on a date? And I'm going, I can't date you. You're a criminal. And so...
And is that Mark?
Yeah. And
Mark Reed?
Mark Chopper Reed, yeah. He's very famous. And so when he left the station, I said, hey, Sarge, what was that guy in for? And he goes, oh, hitman, murder, chopping people's heads off. Yeah. And so, yeah. And,
that's it?
Yeah. And then he became, after a few years, he became a stand-up comedian, like in Australia. Like, he's very famous, yeah. He actually chopped his ear off in prison. And I think he stabbed someone in prison too. Like, but he was quite a character, and Eric Banner did a really good job of in the movie. And like one example in the movie is he goes and tells these detectives that he, you know, killed someone, and the detectives don't believe him, you know. And he did make up half of it. Like, he would actually admit to twice as many crimes as he'd done, you know. So, yeah, he was quite a character. But I didn't go out with him, no.
So with all of the stress, you know, and anxiety of that profession, it probably draws up sexual desires. Because stress can do that. So, tell me about, you know, what it was like having a personal life, a love life, being in that profession. It's an interesting profession. And, you know, maybe any kind of love triangles or anything?
Yeah, well, there was actually. A bit like Sex in the City, which, you know, I sort of modelled my memoir on that, you know, the chapters and everything. I was dating, and actually my ex read this recently and was a little bit upset because he didn't know about this. But I was in love with a young footballer, and he got seconded to play for a team. And it's basically the equivalent of going from LA to San Francisco. So he was playing for St Kilda, and then got... what do they call it when they, you know, the team takes you on? Anyway, he started playing for...
He signed a contract.
So like the minor league to the majors kind of thing?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. To Perth, you know, to play for a team over there. But I just graduated from the academy, and he said, come over and live with me and follow, you know, my career. And I'm like, you can join the police force there. And I'm like, no, I'm not going to, you know, go over. So I was very much in love with him, but I stayed back. And then... you know, I was 19, so I started on the side dating other guys, including a detective. And so, yeah, there was a bit going on there. But you have to read the book to find out what happened.
So what kind of a triangle was it? Was it like a calm triangle or a Bermuda triangle? What kind of triangle was it?
Maybe triangle's not the right word, but, you know, like in Sex and the City, Carrie was in love with Mr. Big and... Aiden, I was in love with two guys at the same time.
Mm. And how did it end up?
I ended up... Gosh.
Is it in the book?
Yeah, you got to read
the
book.
So we don't want to ruin the book.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we could only go home and fantasize tonight how it transpired and ended
yes.
up.
Okay. Yes, yes.
Okay. Or we could just go on to Amazon.
Thank you, Chris.
Yeah. George? There we go. Go on to Amazon. And you can buy the book, Wendy Wilkins. Well, my fingers are in the way. Sex, Love, and Cops, which I think is a phenomenal combination. Now let's quickly fast forward. You leave law enforcement. Mm-hmm. And then what do you do?
Well, I had a few different jobs, but I always wanted to be an actress. So, well, in between, I became a really... successful realtor, which kept on stopping me from becoming, you know, pursuing my acting career, because I got bigger and better jobs. I was actually the number one realtor in Melbourne for a few years.
That's wonderful.
Thank you. And I really enjoyed it, you know, and I think the fact that I was a cop helped me, because I wasn't scared to ask for the money, you know, sort of interrogate people in a nice way to find out what they really wanted, you know. So, so, you know, I mentor some people in real estate, and I say, you know, time is money, and you really have to ask for the money, because if people aren't prepared to buy...
So were you an aggressive closer in real estate? Like, did you really kind of almost like interrogate them? And
yeah, but they didn't know it, you know?
So you were like Rihanna in her song, Bleep, Where's My Money?
Not that tough, but, you know, I was a billion-dollar realtor before the million-dollar listing guys.
So you are a woman and you are number one in the real estate agency.
Yeah.
And the second one was a guy.
Yeah. Well, maybe I don't even know who was second.
So what are you trying to say, Tiffany?
I see. So how was it? I mean,
you know, it's interesting. There was.
What do you mean? What I'm trying to say. What do you think?
There was a guy. So I worked for. You know, I did general real estate, but I worked for a developer mm-hmm, like mm-hmm. and did major projects. So we had a few agents, and there was a guy that was in the office longer than me, always kind of knew more about what I was selling than, you know, quite jealous.
That's what I mean. That's what I'm getting at, Chris. Yeah, you hear me?
Yeah. And I even remember that one time I was started selling this development, and some the so-called big realtors in town came into the display suite, and they were kind of making jokes. Mm-hmm. And I way surpassed them. You know, without even thinking, that wasn't my mission. I just really enjoyed what I was doing. And actually, I wasn't counting the money. That's the really important thing. I was enjoying closing. Yeah, the closing and helping people, actually. It really, I enjoyed seeing people get what they want.
Yeah.
And it's also building wealth through property. I really do believe, you know, while you're sleeping, real estate still is the...
Money never sleeps.
Yeah, the way to go, you know. They're not making any more land. So, yeah.
And then what?
So then I, you know, I kept on having this bug, and someone told me a few years ago that what you play at as a child is your vocation. So when I was a child, I used to put shows on for my grandfather, and I'd make my brother and sister be in them. But the funny thing was, I'd charge him 20 cents entry. It's like a quarter, you know. And who does that as a, you know, 8-year-old?
And you were charging him for what?
Coming, you know, as an entry fee to come to the show.
And it was like your own little show you were putting on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Which my brother and sister were very reluctant to be in, but I made them, you know. And so, but I just think back now, like, wow, I kind of knew it was
a businesswoman. Yeah. You know, even as a toddler.
Yeah. It's crazy. So, but I always wanted to do the acting, and, you know, I was the lead in the school play and things like that. But I finally made the move, and because I was pretty well known as a realtor in Australia, I felt like, oh, changing hats would be weird. So I moved to London. Mm. And studied acting there. I went to the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts, studied Shakespeare, because I really felt like it was a craft, which, by the way, someone put on Australians in LA the other day, just to digress, that, oh, I have someone coming to LA, and they're an influencer, and they need an agent, and they're going to dabble in acting. That really made me angry. It's the craft, you know? It's like, dabble? What do you mean dabble? Like, I've spent years, you know, studying.
Yes, that's ridiculous.
That's an insult. I know. I almost was going to comment, but I thought, no, don't say anything.
They talk about you?
No, it wasn't me. It was just someone in general asking on a Facebook, you know, do you have an agent that can rep this person that wants to dabble?
Dabble. I mean, nobody's going to represent somebody who wants to dabble.
I know, right? So that was, you know, kind of... So I really felt... I need to learn the craft, work on the craft. But I will say that in hindsight, maybe a little less studying and a little more doing. You know, I was a bit nervous to actually do before the study. And in some ways you learn by doing. So a bit more balanced of that, I think.
So tell me more about Shakespeare. What's your favorite Shakespearean play?
Oh, well, it's not my favorite. I had some embarrassing auditions.
Yes, let's talk about that.
Let's talk embarrassing about the embarrassing moments.
It's the best.
Yeah, I just remember I did an audition for an acting, the Actor Studio in London, and I was so green. But my teacher at RADA suggested, you know, go, because she thought I was a pretty good actress, but I really did such a bad audition. I can't remember which play it was, but it was Mrs. Winterbottom, I think, or something like that. And, you know, I was getting a letter, but, you know, the worst thing you can do is mime. And I'm like, ooh, I've got a letter. Let's see. Anyway, years later, I just feel like, oh, when I think about that, I want the ground to open me up and swallow me. And, you know, that was a really bad audition. But while I was studying at RADA, some of the teachers were really amazing. There was a sonnet teacher who used to say, you know, Shakespeare was bisexual. And, you know, to be or not to be, you know, and all these examples. And so that was pretty interesting.
That's interesting to think about.
Yeah, I really actually loved studying the sonnets. And, you know, they're the small poems, and there's some beautiful ones.
I heard Shakespeare is a woman.
I never heard that. but maybe. Mm. Well, there is some talk there. It was a number of people. It wasn't one person.
Really?
But mm-hmm. I don't know.
I think we got ourselves an idea for a limited run show about Shakespeare.
That is a great idea.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I thought of it, so it's on air, so it's my idea.
Okay.
Okay.
Go for it.
Remember that.
Then I, from London, I was doing a little bit of theatre, a few things, and I realised I wanted to do film and TV. So I thought, okay, where's the centre of the universe for that? So I moved to Hollywood, but, you know, it's not that easy because you have mm-hmm. to, you can't mm-hmm. work because you have to get a green card and all mm-hmm. those things. So mm-hmm. it was basically starting over twice, you know, starting over mm-hmm. in London mm-hmm. and then starting over here.
How long did it take you to get an agent?
Huh?
How long did it take you to get an agent once you moved to Hollywood?
You know, I got one pretty quickly, but it was, you know, he was really nice, but it was really low down the
yeah,
rungs.
Yes. One.
And
yeah.
getting agents is not difficult.
Yes,
it's just
it
an agent that work. It's
yes.
difficult.
And you know, actually, you just reminded me. But he did commercials too, and I had to take my dress off and show myself in a bikini. I mean, that's so politically incorrect now, right?
Yeah.
So.
Well, not if you're doing a commercial for like Coppertone or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, yeah. Right?
What was it for, though? What was the commercial for?
No, for repping me. He wanted to see my body.
Well, was it that he felt like yeah. you should mm-hmm. have some pictures to market for commercials in a bathing suit?
I will say I didn't feel, at the time, I didn't feel it was sleazy or anything. He was kind of professional about it, but thinking back now, it's kind of, they probably don't ask you to do that now.
You don't think?
I don't know, do they? It just seems like these
days.
I mean, if you were going to model for Victoria's Secret, can you do that wearing a bathrobe and not expose yourself?
Yeah, but this wasn't modeling. This was an acting agent, so. But
okay.
I had no problem with it. It's just like, mm-hmm. it was.
What was the first professional job you booked in Hollywood?
I booked a commercial. Oh, this was a funny one, actually. I booked a commercial for Warner Brothers. Now, this will age me. It was, you know how we were going from analog to digital? So they were showing, it was that, the commercial to do with that. No, Time Warner, maybe it was. I can't, it was one of those. But I had to, I was like a farmer's wife. And my agent said when, for the audition, don't dress up, don't be overly made up, you know, and do nothing. That was a kind of...
Did you do like a hillbilly accent, like, hey, Paul?
Yeah, it was just like, it was sort of like, be down, be simple. And the whole thing was, we're supposed to be trying to change the channel with the remote.
Yeah.
And it doesn't, you know, what's wrong? It's gone to snow. And, you know, and then there's about the analog going to digital. So the first day was in the studio and we're walking along and something. And then the second day was in Chatsworth and we're, you know, in bed, farmers, you know, we're watching TV in bed, but, you know, pajamas and everything. Now, I'd just moved from Australia and all the camera people were making jokes. Oh, the next one's going to be nude. Now, I was thinking, this is so unprofessional. Mm-hmm. Why are they talking like that? But then I realized they were making jokes because, did you know Chatsworth,
it's the porn capital
yes,
of the world.
Exactly.
How did
so,
I know that?
Yeah. So
yes,
that's
how do you know that, Chris?
So that's why they were making the jokes, but I was like, what's going on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who would have thought? Chatsworth, the porn capital of the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, not me. I don't know anything about porn. Tell us more.
Neither do I. I know nothing about it.
Oh, and then that reminds me of another story. When I was leaving the real estate to go into acting, one of my main clients, or a very great client of mine, she was Australian Businesswoman of the Year. You know, she bought a property from me. We became quite good friends. And she knew I was moving to LA to study acting and become an actress. And she said, oh, we just got back from LA and we stayed with a really good friend of ours who's a director. We should introduce you. And then she said, oh, no, he does porn.
Who was the director?
No. But she was a really conservative, lovely lady.
See Ron Jeremy walk in the room, right?
Yeah. I actually met him. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
And?
He was nice.
On set?
No. No.
Well, he did mainstream movies, too.
Oh, yeah. Really? No. He did. Yeah. A few. At a club. You know, on Sunset, I think, like, the Whiskey a Go-Go or one of those. Yeah.
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 Yeah, he tried to hit on my mom one time. And,
oh, really?
Yeah, my mom was like, no, thank you. Yeah.
So can you do Ron?
I can't, no.
You never tried?
No, I've never tried.
Okay.
No, I don't need to be a deer in headlights. I can't do
How
you
would
know
Matthew...
About, you know about Trump, that's about...
How would Matthew...
Stormy Daniels says she's regretting she can't have my you-know-what anymore, that I could tell you. She wants that orange you-know-what in her you-know-what.
No. Oh, that's good. That's good.
Trying to be PC here.
So let's go a little forward. So you're starting to get work in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
You were a cop, then you were a top realtor. You come to Hollywood. Mm-hmm. You're asked to show yourself in a bathing suit. You then book a job and start filming in the porn capital of the world. What are you thinking at that point of your career? Is everything going the way you wanted it to go? And what
did you
want
to go back to real estate? Go back to Melbourne?
No, I didn't. But I, I was. They were joking, and then it was really nice, and it was actually a really lovely experience, and I was kind of excited. It felt like things were going quite well, but then and I was non-union then, so yeah. And then as soon as I became union,
you kind of get more limited, right?
Because yeah,
you have to, yeah.
And I actually became then I started competing with, because I started acting so late, so every job I was competing with were really well-known actresses, mm-hmm. and I just missed out every time. So
who's the first well-known actress when you think back regarding that situation?
Oh, I don't like to say those sort of things, but I did book a role actually. I don't know if I should say it.
You should say it.
I actually booked a role in a movie, and I was sort of one of the main characters, and I think Linda Carter was up for it.
Wow.
And
wonderful.
Yeah, and I got it because it was a really low budget movie, and
I see.
They couldn't afford her. Yeah. So they got me. But
so it could have been Wonder Woman, huh?
Yeah. Okay. And it's funny, my initials are WW, and some people used to call me Wonder Woman. So
there's so many like prolific Australian actors now, but during your time when you were starting out, were there many Australian actors at that time, or in Hollywood?
Again, I started so late, and there weren't that many here, actually. But I booked a job here back in Australia for the longest-running TV show called Neighbours, which Margot Robbie, that was her. Every main actor you could think of, Australian actor, was in that series, and I had a guest star. So I went back to Australia, did the audition, and I remember at the audition I said... car, like an American, and I'm actually Australian, so but I still booked the job. So, but I heard it in my, that I was saying a word in an American accent, and I was with the two main leads, so it was a fun little job. Yeah, I think that show's just been cancelled after it was the longest running show. And
really,
yeah,
it was like a soap opera.
It was kind of a mix between, I suppose, a soap and Beverly Hills 90210.
Okay.
I suppose.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And here you are in Beverly Hills 90211.
Yes.
How ironic is that?
Right.
Now let's transition a little bit further. Mm-hmm. You get into directing.
Yes. Yes.
Tell me more about that.
And that was not so. Again, because I started acting so late, and there wasn't a lot of work, I started creating my own work. I made some shorts. I wrote the first short I wrote, I played the lead role, but I didn't direct it. And it actually had a really good little run on the festival circuit. We even got invited to Sundance, but not the main competition. It was called Occupy Sundance, because my short was called Big Bully Bank, and it was around the time. And it was about me trying to close my bank account to disastrous results, and it made me crazy. Like, I even made a word up, and I said, you know how it can make you crazy, bad customer service?
Yeah.
And I said, have you ever heard of going postal? Well, I'm going bankal. So I made that word up. And
bankal?
Yeah. You know, like postal, bankal. Okay. And bankal. Yeah. And it's actually based on a true story. I did try and close my bank account, and I just bought a property, and they didn't close it. So I was getting bad credit, not knowing. Mm. And so it was a bit of a problem for a little while. So I made a little short about it, and so that did really well. And then I made some mockumentaries and things like that, and then I've been writing quite a few projects. And one project I'd been working on for a long, long time, and it was like a big budget, like $25 million type of film. And then I wrote another.
So let's go back to that. So it's a $25 million budget, and yeah. What were you doing?
What do you mean?
What role were you taking on in that production?
Oh, well, in that one, I just wrote it. I didn't think I would and maybe play a small role, but to...
So you wrote a script.
Yes, it's still in development. But what happened was, while that all of that, I wrote another little feature that I entered into one screenwriting competition, and it got really high up. And that is the movie that I made, that I directed my first feature, which has Eric Roberts in it.
And what's the title of that?
It's called Death on the Border.
Death on the Border. So Eric Roberts and who
Danny
else?
Trejo.
Danny Trejo.
Shannon Elizabeth from American Pie. Frank Whaley. Me. I have a little role.
Can we see it?
Not yet, because it's in post, but it's at Cannes at the moment. I just got distribution, and they took it to the Cannes Film Festival to sell to international buyers. And it did premiere. I entered it into one film festival, the Beverly Hills Film Festival, and it premiered there. So you could have seen it there, but that was a few weeks ago. And yeah, it was quite a roller coaster ride. I tell you what, being on the other side of the curtain, wow.
Yeah. Where did you produce it?
Here.
So it was shot all locally in the LA area?
Yes. And and I ended up producing it by default, because initially we had a crazy criminal producer. So, yeah, who we had terminate, who resigned first, by the way. So after 4 days into filming, and then we found out he made so many mistakes. So,
Tell us about that. Like, what was it about him that you started to find things out? Like, how did it unwind?
Well, he basically had a breakdown and started trying to extort us, even though he made a lot of mistakes. And then we found out, like, how something happens and then you see all the signs in hindsight?
Yeah.
And, the movie before, apparently he had started to have a breakdown in that one, and the movie after, and, but at first... this was my very first feature, and most of the crew had worked with him for a long time. So
I was going to ask where you found him. So you found him through crew.
He found me, actually, through a casting director workshop, and he...
He found you, or he stalked you?
No, he didn't stalk me, but he initially... his pitch is he can make a movie under a million look like a million, And anyway, I don't want to... Because this is the challenge as a filmmaker, is that there's a lot of people in this business like this. And by the way, cut to some wonderful people helped, us get over the line and finish the film. But, even the film after mine, I'm like, well, why don't they, sue him or whatever? But he has no money, and he has it set up that he's running basically a little Ponzi scheme that, just enough to get some money and then go on to the next. But no one... really can stop him because he, you don't want to go out there, because if you go out there and say publicly, shame someone, they think, well, maybe it was you, that just not happy with him. And he's sociopath, and sociopaths are very good at playing martyrs and all those sort of things. So my advice from an attorney and most people was, do you want to be right or do you want to finish the movie? So we decided to finish the movie. But that's the challenge, and why a lot of these people get away with it. I don't know if you saw a documentary that was just out on Hulu, that guy, Randall Emmett, who's apparently owes people money all over town. Well, this guy's a poor man's version of him. He doesn't go around flying private jets and things. But, you know, on that documentary, it showed he was, one of his assistants was putting all this guy's flights and hotels on his private credit card. Wow. And still hasn't been paid back. And this guy's flying around in private jets. And but the reason why this stuff happens is because, you know, this guy had made a movie with Steven Spielberg, had made a, you know, so he had some credibility, like my poor man's version, had done some good things. And then you see, you know, his IMDb looked good. And I think IMDb should be accountable for some of this stuff, by the way.
Definitely.
Boy, I might get in trouble for that. But, you know, it's like...
No, you're not.
No, but you go on and you see, oh, yes, yes, yes. But a lot of this is... He actually got... My guy got banned from IMDb for selling credits, by the way. So, you know...
Interesting.
This is someone that I didn't know until after the fact. So.
But he only lasted 4 days.
Yeah. But still trying to extort us.
Mm.
And being an ex-cop, I think that's one of the things that helped me save the film... In writing, if you threaten to kill a film or pay me $5,000, that's extortion. That's a crime.
You got him. Yeah. You got him.
Oh, he's, these people are so stupid that they actually put... See, dumb criminals. put it in writing. So actually, you know,
He didn't realize who he was messing with.
That's right. And you know, sometimes...
Wendy Wilkins. Cop, realtor... Producer, actress, don't mess.
Well, it's director, like, can you say don't director, F with me? Writer. Because, you know, I'm a nice person, but don't F
writer.
With me.
Writer, yes.
You know? Yeah. Because I deal with facts, and facts don't lie. So,
that's true, yeah.
So, you know, at the end of the day, you'll win if you're dealing with the facts.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just a shame this roller coaster journey happened because I just wanted to make a movie.
Yeah,
you know. Definitely. And by the way, the movie is shining a light and inspired by true events about sex trafficking of children and domestic violence. So can you imagine like a person that tries to extort that kind of movie? Like with little kids that it's their first movie?
Shame.
Yeah. Shame, shame, shame.
Are you familiar with Tim Tebow?
No.
So Tim Tebow is a Heisman Trophy winner, played for the University of Florida Gators, won the Heisman Trophy, won a couple national championships, played in the NFL, and now he's a very spiritual person and he's devoting his life to God and but also to stop trafficking.
Oh, I should, yeah.
All types of trafficking of children, and he's a phenomenal role model, and I follow him.
Okay,
On social media, so Tim Tebow, yes, he's doing wonderful things when it comes to trafficking.
Great. Well, you know, the good thing is I had wonderful people and I was really validated as a director too, because one thing this, you know, sociopaths do, he kept on sort of saying, you know, you're so lucky to be working with me. I'm going to be the biggest director in Hollywood, which, of course, should be an alarm bell. But, you know, Danny and Eric... love me, you know, really were validating for me after all this bad experience, you know, in some of the areas. And by the way, little segue, Danny and Eric were so excited to be working together again because Eric got Danny his first movie role in Runaway Train. And so they were like a reunion and having a great time. And you know, Danny's really a philanthropist now and doing a lot of things. And, you know, I didn't want to involve anyone. They didn't really know about this, all this going on behind the scenes, except I did mention one thing to Danny and he said, hey, I know people. I mean, he was joking. You know,
I'm sure he does.
I mean, he was like joking and he goes, and you're an ex-cop, so we probably shouldn't talk, you know. But he was like, we were sort of having a laugh.
What is it like working with Eric and Danny?
Fantastic, yeah. They were really respectful, you know, and you know what was really exciting is seeing my words come off the page and the way they brought them to life was really cool. But we had such a tight schedule, so we had to really move fast, you know.
So, Wendy, let me ask you a question. What inspires or motivates you the most?
You know, I feel like... it goes in waves, but when coming back, even today, the reason I said yesterday is to remind myself the reason I wanted to be an actress, wanted to do this, is I want to make a difference in the world. So even if it's one person at a time. And by the way, this movie, that's why I, you know, made the movie. And if it can change one person's, you know, life for the better. And it already has a couple of people, because there's a girl, the wardrobe lady, when she got the script, she said, "I hope you don't mind. I sent your script to a girl that I know was sex trafficked." Mm-hmm. And then she contacted me, and she's an actress, and she said, "Thank you for writing this. If I can do anything to help, even, you know, bring coffee on the set." So she has a little role in the movie, but she doesn't want to be, I can't say who it is because, yeah, you know, she was, but that makes me feel motivated to keep doing what I'm doing.
That's great.
I keep looking at your hand. You showed me this ring during pre-show. But by the way, you have a lovely hand. I think you'd be a wonderful hand model.
Definitely.
Thank you.
I'm loving this ring right here.
Thank you.
Why don't you hold your hand up so everybody could see?
Oh, I'll hold this one up too.
This beautiful hand, like
I like this
French
ring.
Oh, manicure.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
This ring. Yeah. This,
do you know, I have shaky hands, by the way, which my friends used to say, "How are you going to be a cop?" Yeah. I've had them since.
They're
I was
not shaking right now.
Oh, that's good.
Tell me about this ring right there.
Oh,
because it's beautiful.
You're gonna make me cry. This,
that's okay.
This is it's my younger sister passed away.
Sorry to hear that.
I think 3 or 4 years ago. So I have her jewelry, and she actually would be really excited about the movie because she knows more about. Like, I always forget actors' names, and she goes, "No, it's such and such, such and such," you know. So she would be really excited about that, and she was passionate about making a difference in the world too. And she was really feisty and beautiful, and yeah, so...
What's her name?
Fiona.
Fiona.
Yeah.
And that was her engagement ring.
Yeah, which, yeah. And this, I think this was... I'm actually adopted, so this was my birth sister, so I met her, you know, which is even more bittersweet, like it was 20 something years ago, and we became best friends from the day we met, so that's what was really even more difficult.
Sounds like a movie in itself right there.
Yeah, I'm actually marinating on a movie called My Two Mums. You know, about my birth, because I've met my birth family, and you know, and about sort of nurture nature and the experiences, yeah.
Yeah.
If your sister was here sitting with us, what would you say to her?
I love you, you know. Yeah. And actually, that you were talking about depression before. Someone brought up depression, and I never really understood depression, but after she passed, my ex suffered from depression, and I didn't really get it. And actually, she suffered a little bit from it too, and they got on really well sort of talking about stuff, whereas I was more like, just buck up, you know, why don't you do this course, or, you know, get out of bed, or, you know. But when she passed, I had this little depression, because I was like, okay, what's my legacy? She has a child, by the way, so, you know, I don't have a child. I, at that stage, I hadn't made a movie, I'd moved countries, my acting career wasn't really, you know, that big, and I didn't have any children. I was, you know, I'd broken up with my fiance. It's like, what's my legacy? What? Who cares if I get out of bed? Who cares if I make a movie? Who cares if I get an Academy Award? You know, like, so I really couldn't get out of bed for a little while. It's like, why her instead of me? You know, she has a child. Like, but then after almost a month of kind of really not doing anything, I saw this, I think it might have even been on Instagram, and it was just a quote, and it said, "What is the point of life? Life is the point." And for some reason it snapped me back out that just live, you know?
Yeah.
So
cool like that.
Yeah. So how did we get onto that? I don't know. But
well, we talked about her ring.
Yeah. So But I, you know, I cherish the moments we had, you know?
Of course.
Yeah. And her son's really cool, so we're very close, yeah.
And her spirit is with you.
Yeah.
Her spirit.
Yeah.
That's what happened when my cousin died.
Yeah.
And I was really heartbroken. And then one day, I think I have a dream, but it's not really a dream. It felt so real. Like, I jumped out of bed. She said, "I'm always here for you."
That happened. Oh,
oof, that's happened. Oops, sorry.
That's maybe it was Fiona. Yeah. That happened to me.
Yeah, and I hugged her, but she was ice cold.
Oh.
And then she said, "How about let me make you something to drink?" Oh. That's how my cousin was. Sylvie was very, very sweet.
Yeah.
And while she was making me something to drink, she was sitting on the bench, and I was at one end, and she was at the other.
Mm.
And she has her legs up like this, and I stretch out my legs to touch her feet.
Yeah.
And the phone ring, and somebody was saying, "Oh, I'm really sorry about your cousin's death." I said, "Oh, no, she's not dead. She's always with me. Right, Sylvie?" And she was there. She said, "Right." And I woke up, and I was so tired, as if I was just jump out of bed and then jump back into bed.
Yeah. When she passed, soon after she passed, I had a dream, and it was weird. It was kind of real, and she came to visit me in the dream, and she looked really healthy. She passed from cancer, and orange was her favorite color. I didn't even mean to wear that today, but funny. So she had this beautiful outfit on. When she was younger, people used to mistake her for Elle Macpherson, so you can imagine she was taller than me, bigger boobs, and you know, it's quite stunning. So in the dream, you know, I said, I can't remember what I said, but she said, "No, I'm still here, you can still talk to me."
Mm-hmm.
And it sort of gave me some peace.
Amen.
Yeah.
So you talked about you just snapped out of it. Before that, it seemed like you had a very I'll call it successful career and everything done. But you had a moment in your life where, you know, you kind of get lost a bit, right?
Yeah.
So you snapped out of it and you move on. What's your routine like every day? What's your morning routine like? Take us through how you get your day started, because you do so much and you take on a lot of responsibility, which creates passion, but also creates stress. So how do you get your day going? What's your routine like?
Wow, that's interesting, because I have two different routines, I would say. One is a day when I'm 100% on, and one is a day when I'm 100% off.
Like, and most of my days.
Yeah, and so I really listen to my body these days. I mean, if you have to do something and be somewhere, you just have to go. But like, if you have, you know, to be on set or whatever. But if I feel like, you know, not motivated, I will kind of take a day off and do very little, because some days I think some days, gosh, if someone was watching me, what I did today, they would not believe how much I managed to juggle and do, you know, like in the middle of a real estate deal, you know, rewriting a script, sorting out SAG for my, you know, getting another, you know, legal document for the producer, for the distribution company, you know, talking to the editors, like, you know, doing an audition, you know, and then doing some exercise, walking my dog, you know. But then another day, I basically mostly sit on the couch and just watch a movie or relax. So that works really well for me, that balance.
I like the idea of doing nothing and just sitting on the couch and watching movies. I think that's a great thing to do. I always wondered, what would McConaughey think of that deepness of life about, you know, how do you get your day going, or how do you get through the struggles of life? What would somebody like McConaughey
do? Well, I like to go shirtless at the beach and unwind with my $10 million home and my wife, and we just go all over the place and go surfing with Woody and smoke a lot of weed and get my mojo going for the whole day. All right, all right, all right, all right.
That's the word, mojo. I want to get my mojo going. Tiffany, how could I get my mojo going?
Why are you asking me?
I don't know, because you know a lot of things. You're intelligent.
I'm not.
You're educated. Oh, you have.
Say that.
Show us some of your CBDs here. Could that get my mojo going?
Well, the thing is, like, I was using it because my arthritis was acting up.
And what could we do about our arthritis? Because I've got some arthritis too.
You do? Well, yes. I use this relief balms.
Oh, I remember that. Made. I like that.
Right.
We rubbed some on last week. Well, I rubbed some on myself.
Okay. Yeah.
Where?
Yeah, I want some more.
Where? Yes.
On my elbow and my arm and my wrist.
I just rubbed some on.
Don't ask me why I needed it on my
hand
wrist.
Because my arthritis was acting up earlier.
Well, I have a sore knee. Would it work?
Yeah.
Right.
Oh yeah. Yes, but you
can't pull it up. Come on.
I don't think I can.
Yes, you can.
Yes, you can.
Look at those lovely legs. I just wanted to see her legs.
That's right. You pervert.
So you can tell they are my legs, right?
Wow. I'm impressed. Those are the legs that I'm seeing on the book cover. I just want to see the pocketbook and the badge because that just makes it. The badge is.
Gonna make it perfect.
I had to hand my badge back.
And what do you call the badge again?
In Australia,
a Freddy?
Yeah, I don't know why actually.
Why do you call it Freddy?
Kind of a what do you call it?
A Freddy.
A Freddy.
When she would pull the badge
it
on
was
a John.
Like a slang. No, here's the Freddy. We didn't tell them
you're
that.
Busted.
It was like an you know, I don't know. I have to find out actually.
It's a funny name.
I have a very good friend here. How's this? So. He and I were in the police academy together 20 years ago. Well, actually, it was a bit longer, but I tell him, stop telling this story. But he came here to do acting as well. He was a cop for 15 years.
So you showed him the way. He was following your lead.
Well, he contacted me and said, hey, you know, I'm here in LA. You know, it was 15 years like later to do acting. And I'm like, Anthony. And then the next day I went to an audition and his headshot was up there. And since then I've played his wife in a film. Oh, he's in my movie actually. He plays a cop in my movie.
Wow.
Yeah. And why was I saying that? But anyway, he's an actor now, and yeah, used to be a cop, but he was a detective for a long time. But
well, and I think, you know, we were talking about earlier about your question was about, you know, when Wendy was coming up in Hollywood, there wasn't as many Australians.
Yeah.
And now
there's so many prolific. Yeah, there's so many great Australian
actors.
It's
incredible.
Yeah, I know, they're the best.
You know, I think, you know, right now you got, I'm thinking at the top of my head, like Margot Robbie.
Kate Blanchett is phenomenal.
Oh, I love her. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we don't need to go into Mel, but, you know, Mel Gibson was a phenomenal director, actor.
Yeah.
Russell Crowe.
I would think that, would you say Mel Gibson is the one that really brought Australia on the map of Hollywood?
Right. Yeah, I agree.
So,
yeah,
I mean, and that was over 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And since then, it's been incredible. And, you know.
Is there a particular theatrical school that you guys go to where you guys have that niche? Or is it just because you have so many good ones?
Yeah, no, it's quite mixed. I mean, there's NIDA, which is the National Institute of Dramatic Art. But a lot of them came up the ranks through, like, I said, Margot, you know, she learnt on the job, like, being a in this series, Neighbours for years, which, you know, I did a guest star on it, as I said earlier, and just one guest star, I realised how fast they move, so it's a great training ground.
Did you cross paths with Margot?
No, not on that, but I have, she wouldn't remember, but I met her briefly at, sort of like, hi, you know, you know, she's so talented. I remember I'm a member of Australians in Film, and they had a screening of I, Tonya, and she was the Q&A. And
phenomenal film.
Yeah, well, she produced it as well.
I love that film.
And she, you know, she when she was talking, she knew about camera angles. Like, she was really knew so much more than, you know, she got that movie made, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then
I was pretty impressed.
Heath Ledger.
Yes. Yeah, I met him actually. He was really sweet. That was really sad. Yeah. Yeah.
Where did you meet him at?
Actually, I met him twice. But the first time I met him, oh, this is interesting because there's a really, she's doing really well in Hollywood. She's on Yellow Jackets at the moment, Simone Kessel. Oh, we're in the same acting class. And, you know, this is an interesting thing because I'll never forget a scene I saw her do. So she really had the talent, you know. People just sometimes stand out. So she had a little party in the Hollywood Hills and needed sort of someone like as a door, you know, we call them a door bitch, you know. And,
an adore bitch?
You know, sort of to check off the list, a very private, because there was an inclinator. It was for a famous Australian swimmer who she was friends with, and her husband's a director. And anyway... and she said, look, you know, I know you're not going to go crazy, you know, like, you know, starstruck, but, you know, the people coming.
Yeah.
And I think she just kind of said, I know you're cool. That's all she said. So you could do that and then come up afterwards and once everyone's in and have a drink. So quite a few famous people arrived, and Heath arrived, and I didn't recognize him because, and I'd met him once before at a hotel in St Kilda, just briefly, and he arrived. I think he was going out with Naomi Watts then, but so anyway, he arrived and he had a big beard, and I said, "And your name is?" And so he was so humble, like that, because I didn't recognize him. He goes, "Oh, Heath Ledger, you know." And I said, "Oh my God, Heath, sorry, I didn't recognize you." And he was just so, I think that was just an example of the kind of guy he was. He didn't sort of go, "Don't you know who I am?"
Yeah.
Very humble, right?
Yeah. And so,
very humble.
Yeah. So that's, I only met him a couple of times, but I had a really nice experience both times. So it was really sad that he passed. Yeah.
Yeah. It was.
Super talented. Yeah.
Won an Oscar shortly after.
What did he
Well deserved.
Yeah. For
the Joker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, the other great actress that I think paved the way was Nicole Kidman.
She's phenomenal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's
great. And
Yeah.
So you had Mel Gibson, and then about 10, not even 10 years later, because Nicole Kidman in the 80s was becoming big. So shortly after Mel Gibson, then you had Nicole Kidman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know what her first name is off the top of my head, but there's this actress. Did you ever see the movie Widows with Viola Davis, Michelle Rodriguez? Very good movie. There's just one woman. Her first name's Elizabeth. I don't know what her last name is off the top of my head, but she's a great Australian actress. She plays this this high-end prostitute for wealthy guys, and she, I guess her mother was the woman from All in the Family, you know, that played the daughter. What's her name?
Sally.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, she's phenomenal. You know what I'm talking about?
Let's Sally Struthers?
Let me look it up real quick.
Widow?
Yeah. Widows.
Widows. Widows. I know the movie, but I can't
think. Oh, yeah, 2018 film.
Her first name's Elizabeth.
Oh, but I don't...
But she's great.
That doesn't mean anything.
Elizabeth Debicki.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Let me see her face. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
She stood out in that movie compared to everybody. I mean, everybody was good, but she was phenomenal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's next for Wendy?
Oh, wow. Well, and, you know, and I think that this is the thing about motivation. It is, you know, when you're busy, but not just the sake of busy, you know, I find when I've got a lot to do, I'm really motivated. You know, so the more I do, the more I'm motivated. So so I have this project, the one that that I wrote years ago, is a musical. It's very Disney-esque. I'm working on starting to pitch that, and Sex, Love and Cops I'm making into a TV series. So I want to.
Could I be in the series? Can
absolutely.
I have a role?
Back, that's me when I was a cop. I look about 12. Right?
Oh yeah, I was looking at this picture.
Can
earlier.
I be in it too? I want to
really
play a criminal.
Cute.
Okay.
This is her.
Did you plan on making this scene?
You can play Matthew McConaughey.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
But I want to play a criminal.
Well, I'll tell you one thing that I can't wait to employ all my friends. That's, you know, when I was in real estate back in Australia, like with selling a big development, half the people that worked for me were my friends.
That's nice.
Because, yeah, and it's, I mean, why wouldn't you have people, and it's like what, God, I'm blanking on their names.
And they probably get you more, too, what you're about, so it makes sense to hire them, yeah.
But and we're friends now, right?
Yeah. Well, I don't know, you said you're a bad guy, so
well, I play one on TV.
Well, you know, we'll have to sort of,
you know what's
boundaries.
So here's what's interesting, I get cast at times for auditions for cop.
Yeah,
roles.
I can see that. I can see you as a detective. I don't know, you got that sort of, well, you know, you ask a lot of questions. So,
yeah.
You know what's kind of annoying for me? I never get cast as a cop.
Mm.
And I really was one. Though I did just do a film where I played an FBI agent. But it's like, I really was one.
You did know? You plan on making this like a TV series or just a straight movie?
You know what? I've written a few sort of jumping off, you know, from this. I feel like, and I've been talking to a few people about it, so, you know, ready to pitch, but I feel like I really like the sort of TV series idea of a cross between Sex and the City and maybe Law and Order, I don't know, because one thing I've really noticed, you know, and what's quite cathartic about writing you know, back about then, is things haven't changed that much. There's still problems with diversity and, you know, and bad cops and yeah. crime and you know, my girlfriends and I, we grew up watching Sex in the City, and it helped mm-hmm, us mm-hmm. in our era to have a bit of sexual awakening and all mm-hmm. those sort of things. So I feel like making a series like this with cops, we can, you know, my idea of not doing a documentary but having a narrative form is still sending a message but not hitting you over the head with it, you know. And
by the amount of being too preachy, right?
Yeah, yeah, and opening up conversation yeah. because yeah. if you see on TV something happening, then it might make you think twice about judging somebody or, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I grew up watching Starsky and Hutch.
Oh, yeah. Mm. I know, yeah.
And Beretta.
What about mm-hmm. when I was a cop, mm. they used to call me policewoman from Angie Dickinson.
Angie Dickinson, policewoman. She had some sexy legs.
Well, Angie maybe, Dickinson. I don't know. Well, yeah. thank she you. Did. Maybe
yeah.
that's why.
Maybe yeah. that's it. Yeah, yeah. I got to be it.
I think maybe my legs are my best asset, I suppose.
I don't think so. Well, they're pretty nice.
Oh,
though.
Thank you.
So how do people, you know, where can people go to find out more about you and your work?
Well, I probably, on Instagram. I'm
okay. Instagram under what name?
At Wendy Wilkins.
Oh, okay.
Oz, O-Z, which is slang for an Aussie Australian.
Wendy
Wilkins Oz.
And I notice you don't see the word, you don't say the word mate. How come?
Mm-hmm. Like this? This
is it? Yep, that's me. Yep.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And... you can on there you can click on the mm-hmm. up the top about Sex, Love and Cops, which by the way was number one on Kindle autobiography crimes for one,
oh, wow.
for a few weeks. That's so wonderful. I can say I'm that's a number great. One best-selling author.
Yeah, wow,
number great. One best-selling author.
And maybe if they Wendy mention Wilkins. This show and they buy the book, I can send a there's a bonus chapter that's not in the book.
She's holding back on us.
Oh. So if I buy the book on Amazon, I'll get the bonus chapter?
Yes, I will.
You hear that?
I need your email so I can send it to
yeah.
you. Yes.
You can use that.
But you have to
your stand up.
You have to send me a photo with you holding the book. Not
I
this
will.
One. I gave you this one.
Oh, okay.
So Wendy, you're not using the word mate. How come? When do you properly use the word mate?
Well,
as an Australian.
I think it's kind of
you get to get the stereotype of it.
Yeah, I don't use the word, but if somebody sort of says, you don't sound that Australian, I would go, because I don't say, g'day, mate, how you doing? I mean, my brother talks like that.
But mate is another word for, like, friend or pal
yeah,
or something.
Yeah,
you know,
but,
so.
Yeah, I don't think, you know, because I've lived here for so long, yeah. I sort of forget sometimes what's, but I don't think any of my friends say mate. But I don't know. Yeah, I'll have to check that. Yeah.
Okay. So we have another guest today, a returning guest, and
yeah.
I'm excited again because I think he has a phenomenal invention. And several episodes ago, he was on our show sharing this wonderful invention that him and I were talking about how we're going to get this marketed, and I'm only in for 25%.
Boy. I'm in for another 25%.
His name is Hooshang. And Hooshang has this invention that is patented that is to prevent tooth decay in infants before their teeth actually start to develop. And as they're starting to develop, there's a high risk for tooth decay. Because let's face it, an infant can't really, mm-hmm. you know, floss and brush their teeth like an adult. I'm still learning. And I'm an adult, I think, at least. So Hooshang, welcome back.
Thank you very much for having me.
I think what I'll ask you to do is quickly again, because we have probably more and more viewers every week. We're getting a lot of viewers every week, thousands and millions and tens of millions of viewers watching our show, that there's so many new viewers that they have not yet seen your invention. So why don't you take us quickly through it, tell us how it works, how you came up with it, what's the benefit of it, and why parents should buy this for their infants.
Yes, my patent is babyteethcleaning.com. I mean, to prevent tooth decay. I will demonstrate it for you. My invention is an insert that you put in the bottle, baby. Everybody has a different bottle, different size of bottles.
And then the insert in the bottle is what will release.
Yeah, I'm just assuming this is the first liquid, and this is the second liquid.
And that second liquid is what's going to help clean the gums?
That's right. So this is assuming this is the milk, and assuming this is the water.
Okay. And is the second solution just water? Is that what
second
it is?
Second solution is just water.
It's water.
Yes.
To irrigate the infant's mouth.
That's correct.
Oh. So once it's in the bottle.
Yeah. When the first liquid finish, I'm just.
So the milk starts to drain out as the infant drinks the milk. Mm-hmm. And is it through suction that will then create the second liquid,
no,
which is water?
No, doesn't matter. When the first liquid finish, automatically,
yeah,
the second liquid will be released.
So then the baby will keep drinking, but now it's going to drink water to flush them out.
That's correct, yes.
And what is the main reason for that? What's the reason that infants should have their mouth irrigated after milk?
Because the milk stays in the teeth after 20 minutes, that will be cavity.
Wow.
After they
so bacteria can
the bacteria
grow, the sugars
create,
in the milk, right? And yes, obviously sugar creates the bacteria which will decay the gums and the teeth.
That's why I nurse.
Yeah.
Yes, for a long time.
Oh, you're a nurse?
I nurse for 16 months.
Oh, wow.
And my daughter has great tea.
Yeah, this happened automatically.
How did you come up with this invention? What was your motivation?
Well, when I had my first baby, I had to give her a milk during nighttime, mm-hmm, and give her one bottle of milk. Then I had to provide another with just water. So when she was finishing the milk, I was giving her water. So that's.
But how did you know that ahead of time? Was there something
that
you researched?
I had a lot of articles. I read a lot of articles. I knew that milk create cavities. So I came up with this idea. So make it instead of two, combined with only one bottle.
So now you're saving time, right? So it's one bottle.
Saving time and saving bottles, and the kids that they don't like when you take it out and put another one.
Right.
So this.
They get kind of cranky, don't they?
Yeah.
So you might not get them to take the second bottle. Yeah.
They may not to take a second.
That's what
bottle.
I was saying. How do you manage to do that?
Yeah.
So it took me a lot of years to create. This in
how many years did it take?
20 years, over 20 years.
20 years.
Good
and
things
how much
take
did
time,
it cost?
Right?
Pardon me?
How much? I'm sorry. Good things happen to those who wait, right?
Yeah, that's. I hope to give this my invention to kids and to around the world.
How old is your daughter now?
She's 30.
And does she have a wonderful smile and thanks you for it?
She has. Yeah, she has a beautiful teeth now.
Yeah.
Did you patent this? Was it very tedious to get it?
It cost me more than $200,000.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
And I came up with the idea that I think Procter & Gamble would love this idea.
Mm. Yeah. Well, this is not only one invention. I had different kind of inventions until I got to this point.
Right.
How many different inventions to get to that final product?
I had three patented. This is the third patent.
Mm. Have you gone to Shark Tank yet?
I was going
to
ask that.
No, the Shark Tank wants the product that is already being sold in the market.
Mm-hmm. So they want to see revenue already being driven.
They want
Have you thought about, and we talked about this when you were here the last time, have you thought about going to certain types of shows? Like I would say, sometimes they have home shows where it's like home consumable products, like cleaners and this and that. And people go to these shows. They're in Las Vegas, Los Angeles, all over the country. And they showcase their product. So like some of the products that we see on TV now started out with these, going to these shows, like OxyClean and Flexil, you know? Mm. I mean, they all started at these shows before they became known on TV. Have you thought about going to shows?
Good idea.
Yes, but I think it needs a lot of money to do that. Mm. But otherwise, this is a good idea. I probably should do that.
Because when I've been to these shows before, and when you go to these shows, people are walking around, but also manufacturers are walking around looking at what can we buy that's already invented. And then they go after that product. Now, sometimes you do your own self-marketing and you take it to the next level. But in many cases, it could be a large manufacturer like Procter & Gamble or whoever that will come by and say, we want it. And they're going to say, Hooshang, we're going to give you X amount of money. And you're going to split some of that with Chris Sloan for coming up with this wonderful idea. And then you're going to live happily ever after.
And don't forget your co-host, Chris.
Well, I'm going to give some to Tiffany.
Okay.
I'll add a my cut.
Okay, no problem at all. I love to. I love to.
So where could I go and buy this now?
Right now, they can order it if they wanted to order it, like a call. 310-560-4444.
Say that again. Say it slow.
310-560-4444. Or they can go email by email, order predk@gmail.com.
predk@gmail.com. You want to hold on the box?
Predk@gmail.com.
Okay.
And so hold up the box.
Order. That means the email is ordercpredecay@gmail.com.
Okay. Yes.
That's wonderful.
And how much is it?
$15 retail.
And how long does it, how many times can you use it?
Forever.
Oh.
I think that's a phenomenal investment for the gums and the teeth of your infants.
Oh, only need two.
It's phenomenal.
It? Absolutely.
I mean, $15. To ensure that your infant's going to grow and their gums and teeth coming in are going to be healthy, that's priceless.
Yeah, I should mention that it's being manufactured in U.S.
Oh, that's good, yeah.
And BPA-free.
Local.
So it's made in the USA.
Made in USA, BPA-free.
And why is BPA-free important?
Otherwise, it's cancerous. Mm-hmm. The plastic is cancerous, especially for the baby. So
this is safe.
That's why
I
made a product in China. It cost me around $50,000. It wasn't BPA free.
Oh, gosh.
So I have to pay another $50,000 to make it BPA free.
Yeah.
Yes, wow. Because the thing is like, that is not BPA free, it can really hurt you. Because the good thing is, I was allergic to that. This is when I was an adult. I heat something, and then after I eat the food, I got really sick because it wasn't BPA free, like he said.
Mm. What would Mr. Trump think about BPA?
It's not only the bottle. Anything,
it's fantastic,
anything
that I could tell you.
Plastic should be BPA free.
Mm-hmm. All plastic should be
all
BPA.
Plastic
is that true, Mr. Trump?
Well, it's not as good as my idea of using V rays to cure COVID, but it's second fiddle, that I could tell you.
What about the bleach?
Oh, that's what I was trying to get at. Yeah, yeah. He's not a genius like I am, but that's phenomenal, that I could tell you. I would definitely choose it over my Trump steaks, that I could tell you. Believe me, because I just got totally bankrupt from those.
You know that 40% of the kids from 2 years and 5 years, they have a cavities, 43%.
That's too young. 2 years old, you start growing cavities.
And when the kids or the infant or babies, they have a cavity more than three, they go through anesthesia. So it's not worth it.
That's why I nursed for 16 months.
Yeah, I don't think anesthesia is a good thing to...
No.
It's costly, it's dangerous, it's not healthy. So... I think this is a good idea to invest.
And I think it's a good thing too, because if you have something like that, and at a young age when they start developing teeth and they're eating certain foods, I mean, you know, in the United States especially, there's a lot of sugar in foods. So if we're eating, you know, maybe some sugary cereal, they could still suck on the bottle and get some water out of it at the end and kind of rinse their mouths.
Yeah, but after 2 years of age, they're using a zippy cup.
A zippy cup?
Zippy cup. So this can go to zippy cup too.
Oh, wow.
So it's actually adaptable in a zippy cup. So now what are the age groups of a zippy cup user?
Until I think 5 years old. Yeah, this is zippy cup.
That's it? Like, so they stop using it at five?
No. Yeah, I think around that. So this is a zippy cup.
Because I'm still using one.
You can't put it this
way. Now I'm embarrassed.
Yeah, this is a zippy cup. You can put this insert over here.
Wow.
Genius.
And suck it from here. And, you know, the insert is adjustable.
Do you have anything that'll work with a hookah?
No.
How about a bong? Because you might save thousands and thousands of bong users' teeth. Just thinking. And if we go that route, Hooshang, that was my idea.
That'd be a top seller in California.
That was my idea.
What is the percentage you want?
For that one, it's going to be about 65% on that one. Yeah.
That's all.
It's just business.
It's the tough
Nothing
business
personal.
Partner here.
And what Nothing do I personal. Get from it?
You'll get a piece of my action. Yes, because you'll be doing the infomercial.
Well, that's cool.
You'll be puffing the bong saying, look at my teeth. And she's got beautiful teeth, so it's going to work.
Yeah.
Do you think you'll be okay sucking on a bong?
Depends. How much I'm going to get paid for it.
We'll talk about it after the show. Okay, we'll talk about it after the show. Well, Hooshang, thank you for coming again.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Saving.
I hope you get 25% of the.
Oh, I hope so too. I hope so too. I'm banking on it, literally.
It's a great invention. Yeah.
But you're saving children's gums and teeth. And I think we talked about earlier what some of our passions were in life. And obviously, this is a passion of yours, and it's driven you to spend 20 plus years and hundreds of thousands of dollars. So we know that's got to be a passion.
Sure.
So thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you very much. You know that this is...
Yeah, so it fits every size.
Oh, how about that? There's more.
No, it fits most of the bottles in the market.
You could probably put that in any type of container, even for adults. Because think about it. If you're an adult, the stuff we drink, coffee and citrus juices, we still should be irrigating our mouths.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
So I think we could use that for just about anything. Mm-hmm. Even if, you know, you have a flask with some vodka in it. How about that? And we had Wendy here today. Wendy Wilkins, author of the memoirs. And I still want to know what the difference is between a memoir and a novel.
But a memoir is the like truth. A diary.
It's
yes.
the truth.
Exactly. You have her diary of her sex, love, and cops.
I'm going to read it all. I'm going to expose this.
Memoir. It's my memory of what happened. Yeah.
It's her memoir as a cop, busting prostitution rings and working with the most deviant and dangerous people in Australia. Sex, love, and cops. Then in the... entertainment industry, writing, directing, producing, acting. I'm impressed that I'm even in your presence.
Thank you.
Yes, and Wendy's very nice being
hopefully
here.
She won't forget about me.
It's an honor being here. So don't forget about Chris.
Don't forget
he's
about
very sensitive.
If you
and don't forget about
put
all
me
any
in your
of
next
us.
Project. No well, pressure.
You can follow her on Instagram.
Yeah,
like
we'll
I
follow
did.
Every, each yep. other. When
I'm going to follow Wendy everywhere.
And okay. Now I'm getting a little.
She's getting her pepper spray out
little,
right now.
Little worried, but and don't forget. Yeah, you can follow me on Insta, and I'll start once we do know where we're going to release the movie Death on the Border. Mm-hmm. Please, everybody.
I want to be there.
Watch it.
It'll be
streaming, but I'm not sure where.
Great.
Yeah.
Good. Great. My movies will be streaming too. I will email you the details because I'm
Perfect.
Sure Chris is bored from listening to
no,
it.
No, I'm excited because she's booking more work than
no.
Tom Cruise.
Well, we can all follow each
And that's hard to do. And Chase, thanks for coming.
Thank you. Absolutely.
And
wait,
Donald,
I want to ask Chase
fantastic.
Some questions. Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
Chase, I love your imitation of Mr. Trump. That was really, really wonderful. Thank you. So can I ask you, who's your favorite podcaster now?
Podcaster?
Yeah.
I listen to Bill Burr a lot, the comedian. I can mimic him pretty good too. Yeah.
Go on.
Give us a little Bill.
I can do his laugh. He goes. He always laughs like that. I've met him a couple times. He's really down.
I saw him at the Comedy Store.
Yeah, me too.
Phenomenal.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
And tell us something about something that you think is true, but nobody else agree with you on it.
And don't be shy.
Yes, oh, yeah. Be like Chris.
Actually, you just tell the whole world.
I'm going to be doing open mic soon, so I'll share my material there on that because...
When?
I'm actually going to go Tuesday. I don't want to say where yet because I don't want people to see me bomb the first time because I'm just starting out. So, but I'm going to be doing impressions of comic characters like... The first one I'm going to do is Bane from The Dark Knight. I could do
Bane.
Really
well.
Objectality, powerful deceptions of the uninitiated. And yeah, but I have some original material that I'm going to wait till it's out there in public.
Very cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very cool. And then we'll have you back.
It's going to be like Bane, like as an everyday guy, you know, like that, even though he's a total psychopath. So it's going to be that. It's going to be that.
You parked in my spot.
Yeah, I'm going to snap your neck taking my parking spot. Yeah, that type of thing. Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
And what was the last time that you Googled?
I Googled?
Yeah. What was the last time you Googled? Not
probably yesterday. I actually was looking for the open mic places, so I'm gonna down the road also go to the Comedy Store, and they have that every Friday.
Nice.
Yeah, so I'm gonna. You have to have glass thrown at me.
That's okay.
Oh, they don't do that, do they?
No, I'm just joking. But yeah.
Gotta
yeah.
start somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So.
And what should, you know, I ask you, what should I have asked you, but, you know, I forgot or didn't?
My IGCL impressions. I have a lot of music covers I do that I'm proud of and some that I'm not. So, but there's my impressions are on there as well. You can check out of Matthew McConaughey, Alex Jones, Infowars.com, and... You know, that type
all
of stuff.
Right,
so
all
you
right,
can,
all right. Yeah. Living, L-I-V-I-N. Yeah. We're just living.
Yeah, so you can check out my stuff on CL Impressions.
Great. So where can people go to find out more about you and your work?
Well, I'm just trying to get out there. Really, I have an agent now, and she's taking me out there. Not as many auditions as you, unfortunately, but I've had a couple auditions.
Has she asked you to model in a bathing suit yet?
No, she hasn't had me show my man boobs lately.
Yeah.
No.
Would you?
Whatever gets you by in this town, whatever gets you by in this town.
I like that attitude.
I'm just joking.
Whatever
Why
it takes.
Why did I tell that story?
See, the thing about it is, and I know we're wrapping it up, but when I came to Hollywood and started getting, I was wanting people to ask me to take my clothes off, and they didn't. So
you're more than welcome to do it right now,
what
Chris.
What am I doing wrong?
You know? You're more than welcome to do it right now, right here.
I have an interesting story. I'm not at liberty to say, because it was a coworker of mine, but...
Do you want to make up a name so we have a name, though, even though it's not true?
Terry, sure.
Terry.
Yeah, some coworker of mine, Terry, he was telling me, because you know how the Me Too movement, but obviously it's wrong how, you know, men were treating women. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. There was a woman casting director that literally, in order for the guys to get the part, they had to sleep with her. And she's an attractive woman, so most guys are like, sure, why not? You know, like, how do I sign up for this? They've done it for free. But
and what didn't they know, though? What was the catch? Yeah. There had to be a catch. What was the catch?
Well, I guess they just
had a disease?
Right? Yeah, she had gonorrhea. No.
God.
I'm just joking. No, I don't know. But, yeah, I guess, you know, you got to use your tongue to get in this business. I have no idea.
Do you know, I make a joke. I mean, it's so politically incorrect, but, you know, that, you know, I was like, I'd never do the casting couch, all these people. But, you know, then you think as you get older, wow, I've slept with a couple of guys for free. That I regretted, you know. Why didn't I just...
But there was nothing at the end of the rainbow from it. So here you can at least maybe get something out of it.
Well, yeah, you know, hindsight.
So, yeah.
That's a joke, by the way.
Well,
no, it's not. No.
Just got it covered.
We're at the bottom of the hour, and
I thought you were going to say the bottom of the barrel.
Well, I think we hit that few minutes ago. Yeah. But we had a wonderful show, and at the bottom of the hour.
Yes, we do, and I think that we might embarrass
Oh, nice. Did we embarrass you, Hooshang?
No, not at all.
So, okay, that's good to know. Because, you know, he's such a sweet, wonderful father. Oh. And then us.
And an inventor.
This genius talking about your deviants right now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
He's just thinking, how did I get involved in this?
Yeah, right, exactly.
I'm talking about babies and their teeth.
Yeah. And now we're talking about the casting couch. But what's, you know, maybe this is for another episode. What would be the perfect casting couch? So just think about it. We won't talk about it. But what would be the perfect casting couch? What kind of couch would it be? Mine. What color would it be? What would it be made of? I think about that stuff.
I have already have a vision. Yep, a vision of it. Like a wooden daytime bed. You know, craving wooden, all three sides.
Yeah.
And it's like at least had to be full size.
Ooh.
Silk sheets.
Oh, yes.
I like
silk
that.
Satin sheet, really high quality. The kind that we don't, you know, slide off the bed, you know, the silk ones. You know, the really high quality ones. But
I like that. The first casting couch I ever saw had a lot of stains on it, so I don't know.
Gross.
Now we're at the bottom of the barrel.
That's right. Somebody should have, with hygiene, should clean it. You know what I mean?
But I think we talked about a lot of things today that made us laugh. Mm-hmm. We cried a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We talked about careers and changing careers, adapting, self-improvement, how to get through depression. I like the idea. You just motivated me today about, you just said, you know what? I'm snapping out of it just like that. I'm going to live life. And I think if there's one thing I pull from today is that every day we get up, let's just live life, right?
Yep. One day at a time. That's all we can do, right?
Absolutely.
And realize how precious life is, right? Because we don't know how long we have. So
you bet, yeah.
So thanks, everybody. I cherish the time with people. I learn a lot. And honored to be in the presence of all these talented people for somebody like me.
Thank you.
So thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much. So here we are wrapping it up. Until next Sunday, filter 90211. I'm Tiffany Rothman, my wonderful co-host, Chris Sloan, and our beautiful guest,
Chase
Lewis,
Hooshang Broad,
and Wendy Wilkins. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
And don't forget, last but not least, George, our wonderful producer, George Anton.
Yay. Wonderful. Thank you.
Hot.
Yeah, it is warm in here. Are your ears sweating yet?
Yeah, you forgot to open the door, George.
It was probably too noisy.
Well, it was cold, though.
Yeah. It was cold.
Well, that was painless. Thank you.
So, you know, you follow me.
Yes.
Where do you live?
I live on Doheny. So, nice and close, yeah.
I live in North Hollywood.
Okay.
And I work in North Hollywood. I don't want to say you like that.
Oh, that's
I
so
could help, but I was a school psychologist for 25 years.
Oh, good on you. So that must feel good.
It's wonderful.
So now we do ceremonial pictures.
Oh, yeah. You have one and a half?
That we'll cherish. Yeah, here.
Okay, so Tiffany, what's your...
Tiffany, B-U-I, Rockman, because the first one...
B-U...
No, it's in the strip following Instagram. I follow you.
Oh, so I just go to... Okay.
Right. Okay. Just go check it out and follow me back.
Yes.
Are you trying to get that on Netflix, the show?
Which?
That?
All of the... Yeah, I haven't even pitched to anyone yet.
Yeah, it's going to be good. Check it out.
Oh, you're a friend of his?
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Oh, wow. So we need to... Yeah.
I haven't seen him since I moved out because of the
I think he interviewed someone recently, a filmmaker I met. He was here. She did a movie that I went to see. It was about the Australian girl that sailed around the world by herself. She was only 16.
Wow.
And
his job is very stressful. Even though he's famous, but he's
Philip Noyce. He did Rabbit movie.
Film like 8 years ago, 10 years ago, something like that. The kids' film, he was really, really upset because the kids, it did well, the kids love it,
right?
But you know, he thought that it went bad, and this is right after he had surgery. He said, and he told me, I need help. So I called my filmmaker, and she made me talk to his friend, but to do the comments that saved him. He took him to the doctor, and he said, he was so worried that he wouldn't be able to work again.
Because it wasn't good?
But it did well.
Yeah, the personal pressure of,
it's like so stressful. And so, anyway, so thing that, okay, I stayed with him. One time I came home.